बस सर
शॉर्ट
You're left now.
Thank you.
Look here.
Look at the camera, man. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Nothing gives me greater
for the launch of Om Books International latest publication, Poskem Goans in the Shadows, by none other than Wendell Rodrigues. Our chief guest this evening is Lisa Ray, who wears several hats. She's an actor, writer, cancer activist, blogger, and so much more. Thank you, Lisa Ray, for accepting to do the honors and also for the heartfelt quote that you gave for Poskem. Thank you. Allow me a little digression at this point. 5 years ago in 2012, I happened to be at a literature festival in Bhutan, and I'm sure Wendell still remembers it, and struck up a lifelong friendship with some of the finest and most grounded people I have met so far. Wendell Rodrigues, Maria Goretti, Tiska Chopra, Shakun Batra, Arshad Warsi, and Mushtaq Sheikh. Given the yarn spin, deservedly earned his...
Ladies and gentlemen, before I go on to reading an extract from the book, which I'm supposed to do, I would just like to thank Om Books. I would like to thank Palon Daruwala, who's not large enough in the book print, nor in the acknowledgements, for giving us a cover photograph. My dearly departed friend, Mario Miranda, whose illustrations have lent a backdrop to the book, which I did not need to do in words. I would also like to thank the four people who blurbed for the book, my friend Lisa Ray, Floyd Cardoz in the US. We have also Ashok Ferry from Sri Lanka, and last but not least, Shakun Batra, the director of Kapoor & Sons. All these four people were carefully chosen for their various talents, whether it was writing, directing, food, or other areas of specialty like Lisa, who's all of the above. I lastly would like to tell you just a little bit about Poskem. This is a taboo topic which should not have been opened, but I opened it up anyway, because I felt that, you know, this book could be a bridge. On one side, it could be an apology for the Poskem who were treated so badly. On the other side, it could be also those who had sinned against them, it could be an atonement for their sins. And now, if Jerome and group don't keep quiet, I'm not going to start reading. Okay, I'm going to give you a bit of a backdrop. This is very terrifying, but this is actually what happened in Goa. Children were taken in from these wealthy families and then very often treated as servants and bonded labor at that. So this is from chapter one, where Alda, she sleeps with the son of the house. Okay, so I'm going to start with this, where the mother discovers that she is pregnant with her own son. That night, Maurizio saved the bulimia and they both nibbled it down together to the last crumb. Then he tenderly worshipped her body till she felt that sensation again, of doves fluttering in her head, of the Kalangut waves drowning her with pleasure, and those stars seeping from her golden skin to leave the sheets moist and content. Mama Annie was the first person to notice that Alda's breasts had become more rounded, her hips a bit wider, and the bouts of morning sickness. She watched horrified as a kosa or brass pot used to draw water from the well entered Alda's body. She kept her children and husband away from this awful secret by making dresses that Alda floated in. Mama Annie saw the love and lust in her son's, Maurizio's, eyes, and she sent him away on a ship to live with her cousin in London. Alda was lost without her Maurizio. She began to hate Mama Annie. Mama Annie's eyes turned from sky gray to devil red. Her fingers became claws of the leopard that roamed the village. Her neat hair bun became the wild tresses of the goddess in the nearby temple. All this while, this demon watched over Alda. When her waters broke, the demon took Alda to the kitchen and locked the doors. She put a kitchen napkin in her mouth so that the house would not awake with the screams of Alda's throes. When the infant opens its eyes and she saw the gray in them, Mama Annie filled a copper water basin with warm water. She placed the fair-skinned baby inside and pushed its little body into the warm water till she saw the trails of bubbles from the nostril disappear. Then she wrapped the child in a small sheet, dragging her feet to the faraway corner in the garden where she had dug a grave. To plant a coconut tree, she had told Damu, the village gardener and fruit plucker, 2 weeks earlier. Give us some of her comments on the books. Please put your hands together for the divine Miss Ray.
All right, so, hey guys in the back, woo! Pay attention! You know what's interesting about being in a room full of writers is that if you misbehave, you might show up in their book. And not a flattering portrait either. Names may not be withheld. So just keep that in mind, right? So, first of all, I want to say I'm so honored and so proud and moved to be here. And thank you, thank you both Jerome and Wendell and Ajay for asking me to be here, because I have really, really seen this incredible evolution of Wendell's flowering and talents, you know? What I want to say is that Wendell and I have been dear friends for more than 20 years, and I'm proud of that, even though it certainly dates me. But what's interesting about our friendship is that though it was the world of fashion and entertainment that initially brought us together, I think it was actually both of our mutual love for words and for literature and for culture and for discussing everything that we were not defined by that actually cemented our bond. And I have the most fondest memories of, you know, New Year's in Goa with both Wendell and Jerome, where, you know, where we discussed everything under the sun with a lot of great food, courtesy, of course, Jerome, and a lot of the thought-provoking kind of material and subject matter was provided by Wendell. And the thing about Wendell is that he's multi-talented, and he's always been a pioneer. He has a very, very pioneering spirit. And that was first applied in fashion. And of course, you know, in this incredible world where it's all about window dressing, you could say, about glamour, about beauty. And now what's very interesting about this book, Poskem, and the story that Wendell is telling is it's actually about peeling back the layers of politeness and civility and taking a look at an aspect of society that a lot of people don't want to always take a look about or talk about. And some people might say, why? But Wendell made a promise, a vow to a woman called Rosa at her grave, and that it almost can't get more lyrical and poetic than that. And she was one of his neighbors, and she was actually a Poskem, which is basically a child who was adopted by a wealthy family and meant to work, as a servant in their home. And now this is a very compelling part of our history as human beings. And what I love about this book in particular, and everyone has to read it, it is an exhilarating read. While you could say it's heavy subject matter, Wendell's way of telling it and his way with words is so exhilarating. It's so vital and it's so uplifting, which is essentially what the human condition is, right? We have to coexist with our sorrows, and side by side with our sorrows is great happiness and joy. And it's up to us as human beings, and it's up to the human spirit to find the joy in situations that appear to be very dire. And side by side with this story, this exhilarating story that Wendell has told, are these incredible recipes as well. So it really is a beautiful snapshot of Goa, of the human spirit, and how we endure. And again, I want to congratulate my dear friend Wendell on this beautifully written book. This is his third book, gentlemen and ladies, his third book. So we're expecting quite a repertoire now, and I can't wait to see what's down the pipeline as well. So congratulations, and so much love to you.
Thank you, Lisa. And with that, if we can release the book, and can we have our copies, please? If Ajay can join us with the copies.
Check, check. Is Priyank there? Priyank, please come on the stage.
So tell them who he is.
Yeah. So Priyank Sukhija is basically the person behind this beautiful restaurant, Tamasha. And he's originally from Delhi. And this is a replication of the Delhi Tamasha. So give him a big hand, ladies and gentlemen.
And Jerome is also here.
And Jerome is also here. Sorry.
Maybe request Maria Goretti to please come up. Maria?
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And we'll have a few mics to circulate. So the reason why Jerome is there is for obvious reasons. He has to tolerate me in writing mode. This is happening at the hands of Lisa Ray, but we also have Maria because she's going to do the Goa launch as well. And we're going to give her a Bombay launch pad so she gets the book and reads it and stalks on it in Goa.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we'll take a few questions from the audience if you have any, and or otherwise we shall enjoy our bar. Does anyone want to ask a question from the press, especially? We can pass around the mic. You want to ask? Marcellus? Yes. What about them? Well, when I wrote the book, the first thing that I thought was I had to lighten the story because it was so dark. And I wrote as a byline, Goans in the Shadows, because they were in reality kept like that in the shadows. They didn't come out into the halls and sit down. They didn't sit down on the dining table. They hid in the kitchen. So I don't describe them very much in the book. Another thing I didn't do was to describe too much about the villages of Goa or the cities like Lyon or Bombay or Pune, because I left those also hazy. I wanted them to be in the foreground, and I felt it would only be Mario Miranda's cartoons or illustrations in this case that could illustrate the backdrop or the setting of the book, if you want to say, because I did not go into those areas. I did not talk about the sweating crowds that go to Mapsa in a full bus. I left him to illustrate that. And the same thing I did with Paris and with Lyon. I just left it all kind of very hazy. So I kept the narrative racing and running with emotion. When you go from page 1 to 10, it goes through like happiness and pain and then suddenly despair and misery, and that's how the book ran. So Mario's page dividers, chapter dividers, formed a good foil as a background for the narrative that went through it. It means what? Can you give her the mic? I can't hear, there's a lot of chatter.
So the book has been there since Mario?
No, the book was not there. Mario passed away much before the book was written. Mario was there for my first book, Moda Goa, and then sadly he passed away. He was not there, but I knew that there was enough in his archive. So I went to Gerard de Cunha with Habiba Miranda's permission, and she said, take any illustrations you want. So we took what fit us in the book. You know, if there was a temple scene, then we put a temple scene in the chapter divider. So we divided the book into various chapters.
Hi.
Yes.
Yeah, my question is basically, since this is based on Goa and it's a dark book, how much of originality is there in the storyline? And have you actually tried to expose certain familiar names within Goa who are part of the fictional characters?
Actually, the characters are fictionalized to create them, but every single incident that happened for real. Like this story we tell, which I just read out about this lady of the house, she actually drowns this child in a brass tub. It actually happened just opposite my mother's house, and my mother told me about it. And I was so shocked by it that it stayed in my memory, and I bring it into the book. So every incident that happened did happen, though it did not happen necessarily in the way the story unfolds. Your second part of the question was?
Do you expect a lot of ripples or some controversies which would come up within Goa?
Already the people in Goa are distancing themselves away, not from me. They all know that it happened, but like North Goa saying, do you know in Margao, in those big houses, they had lots of poskem? Or people in South Goa are saying, there are lots of poskems in the Mapsa market. So they are each are putting the blame on each other already. And I'm not expecting only praise for this book. There will be many people who hate it, because this is exposing a very ugly side of a very golden, happy, smiling state.
Lisa, one question. Lisa, have you actually interacted with Wendell and read his previous books? And what are your expectations from this book?
Sorry, you asked if I've actually interacted?
Read his previous books.
Yes, I have Moda Goa in my Hong Kong house and my Bombay house. Mm-hmm. They are very different. You know, this is a very different kind of a content and a very different theme and a very different flavor as well. So I'm in particular proud of this one because of the reasons that I sort of hinted at and that you're hinting at, because it is on one level kind of chronicling maybe a not so savory part of Goa's history, but I think in a very humane and a very real and fulsome way. And I think that it's important. It's important that, you know, sometimes we have a tendency to sweep things under the rug. And I think that that's also the role of good books and literature, is to chronicle things like this before they pass into history and people deny it ever happened.
Excellent. Thank you.
I just want to add to what Lisa said. You know, the reason for me writing the book at this time is that my generation, we are the last ones with human rights and with politeness that has come into our world. We would not be able to have these poskens again in the poski is a plural word. We would not have poski in the future generations, I hope. And I hope with this book, the poskens that are alive today are freed from that bonded labor and they become free citizens. You know, they were not allowed, they were given the surname of the family, but they were not given rights to the land, they were not given rights to the house. Sometimes the girls were not allowed to get married on purpose so that they would stay spinsters. Sometimes the girls were violated by the men in the house, and their children became Poskems again, like second generation slaves almost. In this book, this child is killed by the mother because they were the only people in the village with those gray eyes. And the minute she saw that the baby had fair skin and gray eyes, that it would be a scandal in the village, hence she kills this baby and buries it on her own. And this girl, my mother did tell me the story, and she said, this girl went crazy because she went mad because she saw her own child being put into this brass vessel that we used to wash the dishes, and murdered in front of her face.
Any more questions?
That's it, bring that.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Yes, so it's my very dear friend Wendell Roderick's, his book launch. It's called Poske, where it's Poskem, but Poske is the pronunciation. And it's his third book. It's beautifully written. It's about a very dark secret, which is in Goan culture, but he tells the story in a very uplifting way. So I'm very proud of him for shining the light on this part of Goan history, but he's mixing in recipes and he's giving a real voice and a face to people who have gone through injustice in Goa, and hopefully these stories will prevent any more injustice from happening.
Okay, what is the meaning of a Poskem?
Poskem, you should actually ask Wendell, but basically Poskem is a child who would be adopted into a wealthy family and basically treated as a servant, even though they would take the family's name. So you could say that's a child who's born out of wedlock or out of marriage, and then were adopted by wealthy families, but they were never treated well.
Ma'am, audience have appreciated your role in Dobara, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you.